thank you. My idol, that's a good word, yes. I met her at the St. Louis Public Library. She went there, and I totally nerd-girled, like, in front of her. And when she was signing my book, I was just like, what's it like being so cool? And she was like, I don't know.
I was gonna say, I still love, I think one of my favorite memories is of just authors that I have, famous authors I have known. It is my very first Dragon Con, and I'm trying to track her down because I haven't seen her in a year. And she tells me where she is, and I am dressed as Waldo. At Dragon Con, I even had the receipt booklet so that if you found me, I'd give you a thing that said, found one Waldo, found Waldo. So I sneak into the back of this room because there's like workshops or something going on. And I see her and I'm trying not to be unobtrusive because I know people have like paid money for this session. They're trying to listen to the guy up front. But she said, just come on in. So I just came on in, and she saw me, and she lights up. And then the guy sitting next to her just starts cracking up. And then all of a sudden, and of course, that makes the speaker, like, kind of look at the side. And then, and like, he's like, what are you guys laughing at? And then he looks up at me and is completely derailed for the next 4 minutes. The guy speaking is Michael Stackpole. The guy sitting next to him was Aaron Alston. And it was at their writer's hourly workshops. So this is how I met Mike and Aaron, who became very, very dear writing mentor people, because it's all her fault.
Yeah, pretty much.
But Mike Stackpole, I don't think, has ever forgiven me for completely derailing him from his train of thought.
But no, another fun Aaron moment for me is I went to, I've known Mike and Aaron and Kevin Anderson and Timothy Zahn since I was a teenager. So I don't get starstruck around them, but my friends do when they realize who my writing mentors are. Well, we went to Celebration, the third one when it was up in Indiana, and my brother came along. This is my older brother. He knows I'm immersed in this world, so he got to actually see it firsthand. So he found Aaron Alston. He's been hearing me talk about Aaron for years. So he goes up and he starts talking to Aaron, and he's talking to him, and he introduces himself by his name. And Aaron doesn't realize that he's my brother, even though he's talking about his sister. And it isn't until I walk over that Aaron's like, oh wait, this is your sister. Because for the first couple of years Aaron knew me, I went by Allison Sky. He didn't know that my last name was actually Richards. So my brother introduced him as Jason Richards. He couldn't put the two together. So he just looked at me and he's like, I have known you all this time, and I didn't even know your real last name. I'm like, I'm that good. I'm that good at keeping secrets.
I was going to say, do any of you have any specific questions for anyone here at the table? Is there something you want to hear? Is there something you're dying to ask?
Everybody will ask whatever you want.
I've already been recording for like 5-8 minutes, so yeah. If y'all just want to sit up there and BS, that's fine.
I mean, we can, well, we can literally, if you want to give us questions. Yeah.
And there's no children in here, so we have no, age restriction type questions.
There's no children?
Yeah,
there's no children
in
here,
so.
Boobies.
Boobies?
Help from
boobies!
That's okay,
those are nice.
last night when we were doing one of our panels, the wall opened up and Big Man the Cool came in. He's like, oh yeah, this room's going to be turning into the burlesque changing room when you guys are done. So we're like, can we just stay here then?
I was too tired to go to it.
I really loved that one because the secret door opened and then you could immediately tell all the writers in the room because all of us had these really super delighted looks on our faces because there was a secret door in our panel.
That's what I would be really excited about.
I said there went, no, seriously, literally everyone on
we
the
can
table.
Go anywhere from here.
I'm surprised you just didn't get up and follow them out.
Yeah. Everyone on the panel table is immediately like looking at it going, oh, that's so cool.
I was trying to look past him to see what was in the room behind. I'm like,
I think it's just the hallway.
Yeah.
The only issue comes in,
he's always got a grin on his face. Like,
yeah, he always has a grin on his face.
And he's got all this mischief in his face.
Come on in, we're just guessing.
I know, this is just sad and wrong. It's three times.
Help us.
That's just so sad.
I was going to say, this is an author's round table. Feel free to ask
but
us
we don't
anything
actually
you want.
But guess what? I've been
table.
There before. I had a panel. There were three of us and nobody. N-O-B-O-D-Y came.
Yeah. See, that's why we're in that situation.
My workshop took like 15 minutes for a person to come in, and I think they just pitied us, and they were looking for a room to hang out with their baby. They were just looking for a room to quiet room to hang out with their baby.
So, oh, see.
Well, that was your action scene room?
That was my writing realism and action scenes. I
have,
you guys came later. But, you were there because you were in the table with me.
Yeah, because I forced myself on the table.
Yes.
Like I do.
Yeah. That was pretty sad because there aren't that many author writing panels, and they put two against each other.
Yeah, I sat there and I'm like, I was a girl for the kid. I really wanted to go to that one, too.
Yeah, so. Plus, mind you, mine had like the whole table was full.
Yeah, the whole table was full of shiny stuff.
Sure.
I was fixing to say, if, like, all the panels that have been done so far, if y'all just want to do a conglomeration of all of it and just talk about anything and everything.
I mean, literally.
Like world building, character development, story development, plot lines, whatever.
I was
going
to say, you know me from last year. I will literally talk about anything you want me to talk about.
Yes, I know that about me.
Can I ask my question?
Yes.
When you do this,
it's recorded.
Spears, halberds, the big long.
I was
going to
say,
Alan, how did you have all?
Yeah,
the magic
years,
trick.
So,
that was actually a shinnok that I had in there. To advance your plot, to make it have a purpose for why it's there, and it's not just there because I want these two people to, you know, go beat the crap out of each other.
Yeah. After the panel last night about world building,
yeah,
somebody came out and was, they were originally talking to Lydia. Lydia was talking to a couple other people, so I broke out and talked for a little while. He was asking about, because he had built this gigantic world, and he was like, the only thing I'm concerned about is I don't know what the uniform is that they're wearing yet. And I'm like, here's the deal, start writing. Mm-hmm. And the uniform can reveal itself. You don't want to say, he stood there, he was wearing a black uniform, it was buttoned down, it was blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
What you should say is, he brushed the dust off of his black uniform's shoulder or whatever. Like,
yeah.
Allow those individual things to be integrated into the action, rather than like stopping and saying, let me describe what this thing is.
It's funny,
It's
funny you mentioned that, because I actually, better reading a story for one of my male friends, and I love him dearly, but he didn't describe any clothing at all. Like, so I sat there and went,
naked.
so I sat there and went, yeah, I saw that.
Did you?
That was a guy thing, apparently.
Yeah.
But I told him, I'm like, look, this is great and this is awesome, but you haven't described, like you haven't even told me, hey, he's in the uniform, hey, he's in. So my mental picture is that they're having this really well thought out, really, you know, great action scene, completely butt naked. And he's like, well, you don't have to describe this in movies. I'm like, you're not writing a movie.
A picture's worth a thousand words.
A picture's worth a thousand words.
If you don't have pictures, you have to write a thousand words.
Apparently he wrote the Greek Olympics.
Yeah, that's what I was just saying. It's Greco-Roman wrestling.
Maybe wrestling is fun, you know, so depending on the story.
I was going to say, if that's
until
your
you
goal.
Until you bring it into the picture.
Well, it's like you had laser weapons, and he's like describing the semi-automatic laser weapon, and I'm like, okay, I don't think all those words should go together, but but I'm like, what are they wearing? What do they look like? He's like, that's just all details. I'm like, yes, but they're details that matter.
I mean,
the screenplays, you still gotta put it in.
In our case, you know, because we're a duo, I'm always the one that describes clothing because he doesn't have any idea. but he has helped me.
No.
But he has helped me actually because.
I know how clothes work.
From the males.
I know. I've been picking my clothes out for at least 2 weeks.
I forgot all his clothes. Don't get me started.
He knows how to put them on and he knows how to take them off. That's the perfect thing he needs for him. There you go. But he helps me because whenever he describes my clothes, he's like, oh, that thing, that strappy thing, or that dressy thing, you know? And so, like, when we write from a male's perspective, that's what I'm just like, okay, how would Dan describe this? That sheer strappy thing she was wearing.
Is that not a term? Strappy?
Yeah, that's
a term.
But yeah, no.
Yeah, another man back
me up. And then from her point of view, you know, she'll be like the beige silk dress with a slit running up the side. And
I will
course,
say,
and you know, she'll go into all this detail. But from his point of view, it'll just be like that thing that she was wearing that's kind of see through.
It's very strange to look at a writer's Google history.
Oh gosh, sorry.
I don't know the terms in my newest book that's not out yet. I describe a girl in basically in pajamas, but like not like sexual, but just, you know, I don't even know what, I guess it's camisole or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know what these things are. So I literally
teddies.
Was like.
Teddies. They're called teddies.
Well, is it
a little short
well,
thing.
Some
okay.
Of them are teddies, some of them are camisole.
It's not lingerie, but anyhow, I had to Google these things and I realized like if my wife were to look at my internet history, she'd be like, whoa, David. What pictures are you looking at? I'm like, I don't know what any of these things are called.
I mean, I'm
you're
just totally scared.
Get
her a gift. He's gonna be scared to look at mine because for Black Lily, there is later. I mean, this is mini. Well, Renaissance, you know, world. There is later a torture room. I'm like, I don't know what torture. I had to look up torture devices, and I was just like, oh my gosh, I don't want to look at that.
I actually have an illustrated pop-up book of torture devices.
A what?
Yes. I don't even know what that's a thing.
Are strappy things in there?
Yes. And I'm not looking for like sexual. I'm looking for real torture devices.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not looking for toys.
So. I hate to break this to you.
I know sometimes it's both.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, but like if you're Googling, like, what do they call those things you pull fingernails off of?
Right.
How do you bury a body so that no one can ever find it?
Yes.
No, it's the, and I found it, I found it at McKay's, hilariously enough.
Where
I
work?
Yeah, I found it at McKay's, which is this glorious,
cool place.
Glorious place that is gets me in so much trouble.
Especially the young adult section is absolutely the best.
But no, it's an illustrated pop-up book of torture devices, and they go through from ancient Greece all the way up through the Spanish Inquisition, and
which
it's
no
just
one expected.
Yeah, exactly, and it's really nerdily fantastic.
I think I know what you're talking about.
Yes,
because we had a similar one. It was a pop-up of all of Poe's stories. And so there was the there was
Telltale Heart.
The Telltale Heart. And then there at one point there was a guillotine. I don't remember there being a guillotine in any of the stories, but
but it was one of these books, and I'm just like, oh, and this is all this great factual information, and then you have the pop-up, so there are some books.
It's
such a pop-up book of torture.
There's some things you don't need hands-on learning with, you know.
But if you think about if something is going to look at your Google history, right, and then they look at you, you know, Hemlock, and then how long does it take for
I have a book of poisons.
It's one of those.
Hey
guys, show of hands. Whose Google search do you think has put you on an FBI watch list?
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
No,
they would look at mine and think I had a multiple personality complex.
Yeah.
Looking up these deep philosophical religious questions, and the next day I'm looking up something like one of those.
Well, when I typed in how many calories are in a pound of human flesh, I think that probably got someone's attention.
This does not sound like an author's roundtable. This sounds like a roundtable for serial killers anonymous.
Same thing, right?
Yeah, my Google searches are really weird because a lot of times it's when I can't remember a specific term. And so I'm like, I'm just going to type in every similar keyword until I can find that word.
You found the right one.
Well, it's like certain things, like when you're sitting there looking at that going, okay, so I'm 5'2". You know, so trying to defend myself against someone can get interesting unless, you know certain ways and you know how physics works. But some of the best improvised weapons, though, are some of also the creepiest. Like, there are so many different, like, if you have a paperclip, you know, you can do some serious damage to someone and, your cell phone, if you're holding it right here, that's a great blocker, so you can literally do some damage. A paperclip, no, you got the strength.
What?
You're the strength. You open it up a little bit, hold it in your hand, and then you can jab and tear.
Oh, you just open up one end?
Yeah, you open up one end, jab and tear.
You aim at three spots. Your eyes, the little bit of the throat, and if you're going against the guy, you know, right up in that spot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, hell, a ballpoint pen. This is a mini spear.
Back in the day, French ladies had hat pins.
Oh, yeah, the hat pin panic.
What do you think? I've seen these things my grandmother had about yay long.
Yeah, the hat pin panic. There was a whole bunch of people are, agency, and how dare someone be French? I'm like, yeah, you get French from Amsterdam, you have a hat pin.
Yeah, back when I was a kid, like I think in third or fourth grade, you know, they were going, well, you can't have this in school because it's considered a weapon. And I looked at my teacher and I was like, but how are we supposed to do schoolwork? Because technically I could take this pencil and shove it through your ear. And she just looked at me like, what the hell? She didn't know where to go. She didn't know what to say. She was like, I don't know what to do with this.
I brought a butter knife to school one time to try to cut an apple. And they took it away from me. I'm like a butter knife. What am I going to do with this? Am I going to butter you to death?
Have any of you guys seen the movie Shoot 'Em Up?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So the carrot. I can never think of carrots the same way.
And a butter knife is fairly dangerous.
Well, it's like,
No, because the guy that I did construction with, a deer got caught in his fence line. And he walked out there with a butter knife, grabbed the thing by the antlers, and slit its throat. With a butter knife.
I just don't like any violence.
The thing you actually put on a butter dish and just serve butter with, you're talking about a table knife with a slightly serrated edge. Because a butter knife is actually
pretty dull. There is no serration to it at all.
Yeah. There is no edge.
Yeah,
a butter knife is just
for. Like a table knife.
An actual butter knife.
Whole lot of strength.
No, but that could be really, if you get a lot, nice soft tissue. And a lot of power behind it.
You can also do something. We have tried to find creative.
Sequence, but you don't know how to choreograph it in your head, and you just go write fight scene later and then move on to the rest of the book.
All the time. I actually got complimented once when I was doing a writing session, where we were writing and then handing it to somebody, fresh stuff. And what I usually will do is I will do like a bracket, and I'll do like say finish sex scene or finish fight scene in it. And then that way, when I finish my novel, I can actually then go search for that open bracket that will take me back to all the scenes that I didn't finish, so I can go in and do that.
As long as you can, I have no problem finishing that way. I usually say finish really quick. No, here's the problem.
I do my writing at work, and I work at a seven-day Adventist college.
So you can't Google those things.
Not be Googling that stuff there. No.
However, you know, Google incognito search.
And she knew him with great passion.
Yes. Well, no, the really fun thing with Google searches is especially when you borrow someone's computer to look up something real fast, and that person actually happens to work for the government. Because that happened to my cousin. One of my cousins let me borrow his laptop because I was like, dude, I know. I'm like, it's a blood agent. I can see it in my head. I don't know what the actual chemical name is, and that's what I need. So he turned his computer on. He's like, yeah, just go find it real fast. So I typed it in. Somebody from Fort Detrick called him and was like, I need to understand why you're looking this up. And he's like, I didn't look this up. He's like, but my cousin did. She's a writer. He's like, please don't send people to her house. I'm actually not sure where she's living right now.
I'm the exact opposite, though. You know, it's like when I'm writing, I'm usually mentally like one step ahead of where I'm at in the writing process. So I know the fight scene's coming up, and I've already started choreographing it in my head. So by the time I get caught up to that scene, I'm ready to go.
Yeah.
Now, when you're talking a fight scene, you're talking about one-on-one or one versus multiple enemies?
Either one. Okay. For me, half the time, if I have to choreograph something and I'm not sure how it will look, I use writing aids. Like, I have a substantial Funko collection. So for the
things that I need posable stuff for, that's what the Sims are for.
Oh, okay. I was just thinking
because
like
there's action figures, you can pose them in there.
Yeah,
well, sometimes you just need to know physically, I'm standing here, he's standing here, which means you have to be here and you have to be here.
Actually,
no, it's the whole different thing. It's the whole conundrum of how many hands are in the scene.
She will tell you that there have been times where she's turned around and seen me in the kitchen with a sword and suddenly be like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm just figuring this out quickly. Don't worry, I'm not going to kill myself.
No, the ones I worry is when you're like, just stand right there and don't move. And then you start swinging the sword in my direction. I'm like, okay. But see, then I remember that you need me to pay half the mortgage.
Yes. It's the only reason that you don't have to worry.
To go back to that question too, not just about fight scenes, but there are some times when the muse strikes, and if that wasn't dirty.
The muse strikes, that's dirty.
Yeah. So you muse, one of the daughters of Zeus, boobies. My thought process, but go ahead.
But sometimes when the muse strikes, there are certain things like, I know I'm supposed to, like, in sequence, I'm supposed to write this scene next. But if the muse strikes and I'm supposed to do something like two chapters away, I'm going to write that chapter, you know, mm-hmm. that thing two chapters away. Because if I wait till I get to that point and I've like used all my creative energy to fill in the gaps to that point, like the muse might not want to be there.
Yeah.
And so, not to say that like just wait until you're feeling creative.
Yeah, sometimes you have to hit creativity over with a skillet.
Exactly.
That's why I laughed.
When you are feeling creative, just go with it.
Yeah.
On my second book, I did that twice. Two different scenes. I was just like, I wrote them out of order, and I was so happy because these were two scenes that took a lot of work. And then, in the course of writing the rest of it to catch up, the characters did different things, and so then I had to completely readjust both of the scenes.
And that happens too. Yeah, like you have to change because even the muse might be wrong. So when you come back to it, you might have to change it.
Your muse is now insulted and will not give you swords.
But it's a type of thing where, I mean, writing is work, and so yeah, you do have to sit down and like get to the next point. But if you are excited about this one thing and like you can't get that out of your head,
then write
the thing.
My muse,
so sometimes it is bracket fight scene.
Yeah. Or my personal favorite is bracket shenanigans occur.
This book I wrote like, you know, and everyone talked about their day, and then I put bracket, make everyone talk about their day.
Yeah.
Like,
see,
even though I just said it, and I ended up cutting it out.
That's how I am. Like, for me, like, action scenes or romance scenes or anything that's very active and quick, I can write those very quickly. It's the, like, more conversation, mm-hmm. description kind of scenes that those are ones where I'll be like, insert conversation here, insert description here, and go back to it.
And sometimes, and it's a running joke between me and my beta readers, is that I am generally always the last to figure out something. Because my subconscious likes to do hilarious things, because my beta will be like, yeah, this foreshadowing like six chapters ago, and I'm like, news to me. Did not see this one coming at all, guys.
Yeah. You were talking about writing fragments like that, like writing a piece here, you're inspired to write. I've got a novel that's over 100, almost 140,000 words, not quite done yet. And I'm still working on it, but I keep having to do projects for other publishers. But it was almost entirely written in one inspired fragment. Okay, here's a creature that they're going to meet on the journey. Okay, so they're going up the pass, and there's the Grister and the Gobbler. What are those? And I fill that in. And then 3 months later, I finally get back to where, if I'm going from the beginning, I get the point where I fill in the part where they finally meet the Grister and the Gobbler. And I go on. But it was that way all the way through. And eventually, I had to go back, and I had to cut out. I cut out one character. And you have to adjust things here and there. But overall, it actually... that worked really well with that particular project. It's worked really well.
Yeah.
I've got like a fragment here, a fragment there, and then just fill in the gaps.
Yeah.
And you do write it sequentially, you still have to go back and rewrite it.
Yeah, and
sure,
layer stuff in.
Yeah.
And sometimes...
I got a whole like document that's just like scenes I had ideas for. These are for plugging in later.
Yeah.
And sometimes they get plugged in, sometimes I like write past them and realize there's no room for them anymore.
Yeah.
But a lot of times, at least, it's like, I know I want this to happen later on. So if I get to a point in the story where I'm not sure what happens next, like, well, I know, like, here in like two chapters, I want this thing to be here. So let's set that up, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, one of the novel series I'm working on, I'm writing book two, but when I first started writing it, I was handwriting a lot of scenes. So I went and I typed up all the handwritten scenes from various notebooks into one document, and I realized that it was like scenes from five different books in the series. So what I ended up doing was I cut and pasted them in order for the story order, and I gave them the scene titles, and then I created a table of contents for that as a master scene document for this book series. So when I finished book one and I started book two, I went into that document, took all the scenes that I knew was in book two, started my Word document with that, so it looked like I started with like 10,000 words already in it. And then I went and I would just start going in and from the top, writing until I got to the first scene, put the scene in, and went through and I kept doing it that way. So I've got scenes from books 3, 4, and 5 already written. My scene document is actually about 68,000 words for the whole series. Each of my books are really only about 30,000 words. So, and I have a lot more scenes. I think most of my scenes I've written are actually book 3 and 4 for it. So that's how I kind of do it when I get piecemeal, where my character's just like, oh, hey, this is the scene for the day. And I'm like, but that's not what I'm writing today. Fine. Open the other document.
Do any of you use any other writing aids in a sense? I use Excel spreadsheets.
How do you use Excel spreadsheets?
A lot of writers use them.
Yeah, I use Excel spreadsheets because this has so many characters in it.
Oh, okay.
I have scenes.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I've got scenes, time of the day of the week, and character spread across here so that I keep track of what's going on with the novel itself. Again, this is 180,000 words here.
Yeah. She bought me a beautiful thing called Dramatica Pro. I've yet to actually use it.
Yeah.
But it is on my computer for me to try to take this big series and try to do that to keep track of it.
See, I unfortunately can't do Scrivener because I get too distracted by all of the things it can do. So I have to just use your basic, like, I literally write in Notepad and then save it into Word document or whatever, because otherwise it's just too distracting. However, how I organize stuff is I have really, really in-depth, spanning at least 500-600 years worth of frame literature. Because the way I have to organize them is just the characters and in their family tree. So I have my protagonist, everyone related to this protagonist, my antagonist. And so I've got them arranged in family trees because that way I can tell who's related to who, what the specific notes are. And it gives me fun little things to slip in every now and then about, you know, someone who comes from a huge southern military type family and who has like 5 different Uncle Franks. So you can slip in a line about, oh yeah, Uncle Frank sent me that. Which one? World War II Uncle Frank? Vietnam Uncle Frank? Or Korea? Which one? So that also helps me a lot with layering in and world building. But yeah, there's just all the characterization details in each person's state, because I never know when someone's going to suddenly show up and be like, so hi, yeah, we're related.
Post-it notes are also pretty easy.
Yeah.
I don't know if any of you guys have ever done it where you've actually just like taken post-it notes and a blank wall and you just started like putting post-it notes to try to organize everything. There was like a time where I had like 5 color post-it notes, and like one post-it note was character notes, one was world building notes, and I literally just took a wall and I just started putting them on a wall to organize them.
I have some of the huge post-it note things that are on my walls where I've literally taken just like one of the big ones, stuck it on the wall, and then with Sharpie markers, you know, for some of my main characters, got, okay, I know this, I know this, I know this, I know this. Like I mentioned in the world building panel last night, I have one character, you know, tell me, oh, by the way, we're going to solve this by killing me off. And I'm just like, yeah, but by killing you off, we've just opened this door, and none of these people will be happy by this. He's like, but there's a loophole. And I'm like, ah, shit. Which, when you write about fairies and folklore and mythology, there's always a loophole. So, but stuff like that, just to keep it all organized and, you know, out of your head.
And I will say, too, that there's not like a rule.
Yeah.
There's not a, because you talk to any writer and every writer is going to be completely different than that writer next to them. And so it's, you have to be consistent, obviously, but it's really just whatever works for you. If you're the kind of person that you can't put finished fight scene later, you have to finish the fight scene. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
It really is just whatever gets you from point, you know, word zero to word 10,000 or 10,000.
I mean,
I'm going to mention something. I have always written chronologically, and then I sometimes turn around later, depending on what the story is. But I took last year a screenwriting course from Screenwriters University, and I'm not trying to promote them because I'm not sure that they're the best thing out there. But they had us write every scene in our all-did feature screenplays out of sequence, every blasted one. And it was, and at the end I had to take the whole 90-page screenplay and put it back together in an order that it could be shot. And what got me about doing that, and you know, me being the, I've written, you know, 100 short stories, 7 novels, you know, lots of stuff, and was it really kind of opened up like a third eye. All of a sudden I was seeing this in a completely different way. And I had not yet tried to apply it to a regular piece of prose, but I was really happy with what I did on the screen. So I mean,
it sounds interesting and terrifying.
It was terrifying. I was like, oh my God, they expect me to write the end, but I haven't written the middle. All I've got is this weird little beat outline. And he wants me to write the end now. And I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah, well, sometimes I'll get to the point, I know, where I'm at a point where I can go one of two ways, or like one of three ways, and I'm just like, I don't know which one is best. 9 times out of 10, I let gaming dice decide that.
So when you're writing, you say you write it all chronologically, but you know where you're going through the story. Right?
I have no idea.
You have no idea?
I have read thousands of novels. Thousands. I can't even list them. I used to read a book every day. And I'm 62, I've read so many novels. And I've got this natural sense of story order that doesn't always work, for the most time it does. I write in pencil every first draft I do now. Because I found that writing in pencil opens up my creativity in a way that writing on a laptop never does. And I write them from page one to the final end. Somewhere about two-thirds through it, I start thinking more about the ending and the climax and exactly the way I want to work. But that first two-thirds of it, I just write it straight through. And generally, it's more cleanup and stuff that I do rather than wholesale revision.
That's very different from how I do it. I got the beginning down pat. I usually know the ending as well. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I just know the ending. So I've got a picture of it from beginning to end. A rough picture of the story in my head, this is what's going to happen, and then I usually write it in chronological order. Occasionally I've got it where I just write smatterings of scenes and then later connect them. But usually I know where I'm going from the beginning to end, and very rarely changes.
This is the middle stuff.
The middle stuff has been figured out for the most part, but of course I'm busy all day working with my hands and body. I'm busy and I'm thinking of the story all day before I ever sit down to write it. So I pretty much got it down. By the time I sit down to write, I've got a few notes. And it's in my mind. By the time I'm actually writing, it's done.
Well, usually when I write a short story, my sweet spot for short stories is 3,500 words. And usually when I write short stories, I write them in one sitting. I sit down, I write from the beginning to the end in about 2.5 hours. And then I revise it about 11 times. I go through and I revise it and I revise it and I revise it.
Yeah, well, with revising, like, my first drafts for a lot of my short stories, a lot of everything, is just me getting everything out, like not even caring about word order, not even caring about scene order, just getting it all out, and then I print the thing out, and then start a new document and type it all in again, because that helps. And I don't know why that works the way it does, but retyping it deepens the prose, makes it better. But yeah, no, the act of printing everything out and then retyping it in.
Well, it's really weird because I retyped my first novel.
Mm-hmm.
I retyped the entire novel in. And what I found that I was doing is typing in the novel, and all of a sudden I would just go off and put the whole thing in. But then I would come to a phrase and And I wasn't thinking of it at the time, all that, you know, this is like deja vu. And then later I compare the draft, they were almost word for word. The same, that one little gem I kept in from the first draft. So I just don't, you know, I just don't worry about it too much. I figure I'm going to get it right eventually. But this handwriting thing, I just decided was the best way for me to write. That I'm more creative and take more risk if I, and it has to be in pencil. If I write it in pen, there's like, I feel like there's a certainty to it, and I erase things as I go.
Yeah, I think it's a lot like there are some vocalists who insist upon eating potato chips before they get on stage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because they think that it coats their vocal cords. That's insane.
Yeah.
Because if grease went into your vocal cords, you would not be able to speak.
Yeah.
But psychologically, they are more creative. They're a better singer. Because they do that. So I think we all probably have certain things that we do. There's no reason to say you can't use pencil.
Oh, sure, yeah. It's very much a your mileage will and can and should vary.
Yeah.
Well, hell, Ozzy Osbourne, I think, last time I heard it, like whenever he gets on stage now, he drinks like 15 to 25 five-hour energy just back.
That's his purpose.
Why does he have a one-hour he's probably got a metal card anyway.
Yeah, I was going
to
say, literally,
I used to write it by hand and type it in, and I got to where Jeffy was just as easy.
We actually technically
got it. But I started out that way, and for years I only had to write everything before I could type it. And now I'm just adapting.
Nowadays I'm dictating a lot of my stuff.
Yeah,
well, it's dictating.
Do you have anything else before we go?
Did you make writers assemble?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, God.
Well, I'll edit it down if it'll make you feel better.
Oh, you're
actually. No one. Yes. But, going back to world building, is there, when you're laying out a city or, a landscape, does it work or does it work less when everything is organized within a city? Say this is the food and spice district, this is the armory district, this is the political district, or is it just better just to have it randomized, this is over there, this is over there.
Most of the characters are going there, you don't need to talk about them.
Yeah.
All you need to do is just talk about where the characters are, where they're going, what influences them, what influences the story. Let your readers are smart. They're going to figure out that a city's going to have different districts and different ethnic groups that are going to be a little more populated in different areas. They're going to figure that out. That's normal.
I also kind of go back to the Lion King with the everything your eye touches except that place over there.
That's the only thing that matters.
Yeah, that's the only thing that matters.
And then, of course, that's where we end up going.
That's where we end up going. So,
yeah.
So
to me, again, it's kind of like Warcraft, too.
Yeah.
That everything is black until you start walking there.
Until you start walking
and then
stuff.
The shadow fades, and all of a sudden it reveals. So I think there's
Sorry, that's episode four.
We're wrapping
up. We can
add
it.
Yeah.